Hey, CrossPoint, if you were here last week, you heard me talk about Awaken. Now, this is a citywide movement of over 300 churches that are coming together for 30 days of prayer and fasting starting January 27th. Now, we're inviting all of you to take this journey with us. But we also know that many of you may have never done this type of thing before. So I thought we'd take a moment, and it might be helpful to unpack a little bit of why it's important that we pray and fast. So today in the lobby, you're gonna have an opportunity to receive a packet. We wanted to get some information in your hands about what we'll be doing together. And inside that packet, you're gonna find directions. You'll find information about the 30 days, a 30-day devotional. And since together we're gonna be praying for every family in the Nashville area, here, you're gonna find a list of names that are unique for you. Now, you may have heard me say before that I believe that prayer is the most powerful and effective force on the planet. See, God moves when we pray, and what's special is that we're gonna be praying over every name and household in the Nashville area. And like we actually have the names. Yes, that's legal. And between all the churches throughout the 30 days, every house will be prayed for by name. Now, fasting is a powerful discipline in our lives. Essentially, it's giving up something that you want for something that you want more, or giving up something that you love, like food, like a sandwich, for something that you love more, like seeing people come to know Jesus. And if you want to know more about fasting, my friend Dave, he wrote a helpful little book, and we've got some free copies available in the lobby if you're interested. You can pick one up out in the lobby as you pick up your packet and take it home with you and read. Now, we're excited about what God's going to do in our lives in these 30 days. And what he's going to do in the city. Now, I don't think you're gonna wanna miss being a part of this. And prayer is just another way that we go off the grid. And how we pray privately has the capacity to shape who we are publicly. And that's what we're talking about in this series, how a powerful life is built in the places and spaces of obscurity. So I'm glad you're here for week two of Off the Grid. I wanna begin today with an email that I received. The subject line is, "Urgent, my son is missing in Nashville. He's 13. Says, Pastor, I know that you're in Nashville. Please share with everyone. My son was dropped off in a neighborhood off Lafayette Street. He met with someone that he befriended online. The police have been notified, and I'm driving to Nashville now. I need all eyes on the road and people physically out there with his picture looking for him. God's in control, and I have faith this will help all of us get closer to God and have faith in him. Prayers needed. Share with everyone. Call the police if you see him." The picture's attached. And so I got this email a little over a week ago. I was in Atlanta finishing up the break. And when I read it, my heart just dropped. My heart sunk. Because as a parent, it's like your worst nightmare. And the lady who sent me the email, I knew of her. I was a church called 12 Stone back in Atlanta before I moved to Nashville, and she was a part of that church. And so when she reached out, I was just like, man, what can I do? And so I was like, I can call her and I can pray, because I was in Atlanta. And so I picked up the phone. I kind of took a deep breath because I didn't know what would be on the other side of the phone. And she said hello, and I said, this is Kevin. And she screamed. And she said, they found my son. She said, the police just called, and they said they have found my son. It took them 2 hours, and they found my boy. And she was overjoyed. She was weeping, and I was messed up. I was messed up, too. And I thought, can we just take a moment and just show our gratitude to the Nashville Metro police officers and their search and that they found. It's like, and that story has messed with me, because I've been thinking and I've been imagining and I've been wondering, like, what would I have done if that was my 13-year-old? I mean, if that was my 13-year-old, I would have been in the car and I would have been driving north on 75 and I would have been headed to Nashville and I would give the rest of my life to search for my child. And I'm guessing that you would too. And so when we say, why awaken? Why are we doing this with other churches? It's because the heart of God breaks for those who are far from him. That God is not indifferent toward people who are far from him. That his heart breaks for those who are far from him. And as a church, we want to join God in what he is concerned with. And we want to celebrate with what God celebrates. In fact, Jesus in John chapter 15, he says that every time that one person who's far from God, who's lost their way in life, when they return back to God, that heaven breaks out in a party. He says it this way. He says that the angels celebrate. And I love that. The moment they return, the angels celebrate. It doesn't say that they go on probation. It doesn't say that there's like a 90-day eval period where God's going to look and see if their salvation took. It says the moment they return to him that there is a party in heaven. And as a church, we want to party with heaven when a person comes back to God or finds God or is restored in their relationship with God. We want to celebrate when a person who's lost their way in life finds the hope that only Jesus can give. And we want to concern ourselves with the heart of God. And we want to join him in an all-out search and rescue mission for his lost kids. Because Jesus said that's what his mission was. I mean, there's this one time, in his public ministry, he had 3 years of public ministry. In his public ministry, one time he was talking with this guy, Zacchaeus, who had made a mess of his life. And Jesus is talking with him, and he tells Zacchaeus, he says, here's why I've come. He said, I've come to seek and save that which is lost. He says, my mission statement in life is to seek and save those that have lost their way. Because we all lose our way sometimes. And Jesus came to seek. And we want to join him in the seeking. I mean, that's what his public ministry was about. It was about helping people be made right with God. And listen, you can be made right with God in a moment. In a moment, you can receive his forgiveness. You can receive his grace. That's what Jesus came to bring us, that hope, and give us. That's what he gave his life for. And as a church, that's what we want to be about. This is public ministry. Now, he had 90% of his life, 30 years, that was tucked away in obscurity. I mean, he had this public ministry that everybody knows about, 3 years, but then he had 30 years where not many people knew much about Jesus. In fact, he was pretty well hidden in Nazareth. And we've been talking about it in this series, is that season of hiddenness or that time of obscurity is what we're referring to as off the grid. And we all have places and spaces in our lives where we feel off the grid, where we feel hidden. In fact, when we say we want to be like Jesus, if we say, I want to be like Jesus, we're usually thinking about like we want the momentum and we want the miracles, we want the power, we want the presence, we want the success, we want the like mic drop moments with the Pharisees, where we answer our critics and it shuts them up. Like we want the moments, standing room only crowds, like we want the success and the movement. But when we say we want to be like Jesus, oftentimes what we're not talking about is the 90% of his life that was hidden. But you don't get the 10% without the 90%. It took the 90% of obscurity to form the Jesus that we know and we read about in the Gospels. See, it's in obscurity that God brings maturity. And if you try to escape obscurity, you diminish maturity in your life. But in our culture, we want to be seen. We want to be recognized. We want everybody to notice us. Like we want to be visible. But it's in the hiddenness that God grows us. See, God doesn't hide us in our lives. He doesn't give us obscurity because he's ashamed of us. He gives us obscurity so that he can grow a root system, just like a seed underneath the soil. It's underneath, it's in the darkness of the soil that the root system grows that can sustain the future for that plant. And your future is sustained by the roots that God is growing now underneath. So we don't resist the hiddenness because the hiddenness is the birthplace of greatness in our lives. And so God grows us in seasons of obscurity. He grew Jesus in those 30 years of obscurity. In fact, there's one verse to sum up 30 years. If you just think about that, 30 years of your life in one verse. And so here's what we hear about Jesus in Luke chapter 2, verse 52. It says, and Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and favor with God and man. I mean, we can read that again. That's a really short verse. If you're looking for a verse to memorize this year, here's your one. It's pretty easy. And Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and favor with God and man. And so what it's saying is that Jesus matured, that Jesus progressed, that Jesus advanced, that Jesus grew in four areas. In wisdom, that's intellect, that's knowledge, but also understanding God's perspective on life. Jesus grew in wisdom. He grew in stature, that's height. He grew physically. He grew in favor with God. He grew in favor with God. That's spiritual growth, maturity, and in favor with man. That's relational development. So Jesus grew in these four dimensions. And what's amazing is with all the advances of technology and science, all advances in culture, that these are still the four areas of holistic development in our lives. What it means to mature as a person. And you don't want any of these areas to be stunted. You want to grow in all of these areas. Wisdom, stature, favor with God, favor with man. Today we're talking about how do you grow in favor with God? How do you grow spiritually? How do you mature spiritually? And it's important that we note that maturity doesn't happen in a moment. You realize this, like we recognize this. Maturity doesn't happen. Spiritual maturity doesn't happen in a moment. Any kind of maturity. If you have teenagers, you know maturity doesn't happen in a moment. It takes time. But we want instant growth. We want instant development. We want instant abs, don't we? I remember when I was in college and we'd go to the beach and there's a group of guys, and what we would do before we went to the beach, we'd spend some time up in the hotel room doing push-ups. Guys, I don't mean to tell you secrets, but like what we do is we do push-ups up in the room, we do about 100 push-ups up in the room to get our pump on. Because we knew if we did push-ups in the room, it'd make our pecs look bigger and our shoulders look bigger and our arms look bigger. And we might do some curls for the girls. And so we'd like do some work up in the room. And then we knew if we went out to the beach, we would look better than we really were. And so we would do push-ups. But here's the part that's so annoying. The part that's so annoying is I could do 100 sit-ups and it wasn't going to do anything about my midsection. Like my abs would not be developed in 5 minutes, because we all know that abs aren't developed in 5 minutes. They're developed by what you do every day in the gym, and they're developed by what you do at the dinner table. And I learned early on that I love food too much to have abs. I've never had abs. I thought I had an ab one time, but it was actually a fold. And then when I stood up, I was like, well, it kind of looked like an ab. But we want to know, how can we get abs in 5 minutes? And when we just know that maturity, that it takes time. And spiritual growth, spiritual maturity takes time too. It takes time to grow. But I believe that Jesus came to demonstrate what's possible in a life rightly related with God. And he wants you to have a relationship with your heavenly Father like he has. Like he demonstrated on earth. He said, I've come. Another reason, he said, I've come so that you might know the one who sent me. So when we talk about spiritual growth, we talk about spiritual development, we're not talking about an increase in knowledge. We're talking about an increase in relationship. Jesus didn't come so you'd be religious. Jesus came that you'd have a relationship with your heavenly Father. Jesus gave his life so that you would have a relationship with your heavenly Father like he has. He gave his life for it. He's committed to it. And he came to teach us how to have that kind of relationship. And I believe that you can get to the end of 2019 and be closer to God than you've ever been before. I believe in many ways we're as close to God as we want to be. Because of the cross and because of an empty tomb, the door is flung wide open and God's saying, you can know me as much as you want to. But that knowledge and that experience, the encounter with him, it takes time to grow in. It takes a commitment to grow in. It takes pursuit. And Jesus models for us growth in that relationship. You realize when he came out of the womb, he wasn't praying and prophesying and speaking great words of scripture. Like he wasn't teaching, right? No, he grew into that. He learned how to hear the voice of God. He learned how to respond to God's prompts. He learned obedience to God. And it's something that we learn as well. And he invites us into that. But before you learn that, there are two foundational truths you need to know. The first one is you were made by God. You were made by God. You were not a cosmic accident. That God has created you with intention and purpose and meaning. You were made by him and you were made for him. In Isaiah chapter 43, there's this verse, Isaiah 43:21, it says, you are a people that I formed for myself. So you've been made by God, designed by him, and you were made for him. You were made for a relationship with God. You've been created in his image with relational capacity to know God, to have a relationship with him, to have communion with God, intimacy with God, oneness with God. You were made for that. You were made to exist with an awareness of his presence and of his power, to experience and encounter his love, his joy, and his peace, to have that going on in your life. You were made for that. And I think the best way to communicate that is with a goldfish. So does anybody have a goldfish? Like, anybody bring one with you today? Not like the crackers, but like a real live goldfish. Oh, you don't have one? Okay, well, let me see what I have behind the TV. I got a goldfish right back here. And he's swimming, which is a good sign. This is Charlie. Everybody say, hey, Charlie. Charlie's just hanging out. We just named him that, and he's doing all right. They tell me that the goldfish, their like average lifespan in one of these tanks is 5 to 10 years. Like, I'm just hoping he lasts 5 to 10 hours. I really am. We got more services, but I think about I've never had a goldfish live 5 to 10 years. I have, but Charlie's hanging out, and I want you to imagine with me, and I can kind of see the future. Okay. I want you to imagine when I take this net and I was to reach down, I was to get Charlie. Aw. So I was to reach down, I was getting, you're going to like where this goes. And if I was to get Charlie and I was to take him in this net and I was to dump him on the table, I can see the future. Here's what he would do. He would flip, flop, flippy, flippy, flop, flop. He'd flop around and then he'd look up at me and he'd say, why? Right? And he'd give about 2 more flop, flops. And then he'd fall off the table. And if he survived the fall, he'd lay there. And that might be the noise he'd make. I don't know. And he would be gasping for breath, trying to get oxygen. And somebody in the room would run toward the stage, slow motion, and dive out and say, I'm going to rescue Charlie. Don't squeeze him that tight. But I'm going to rescue Charlie. And then they would take Charlie, save his life, and put him back in the water. And then I've received a lot of emails on Monday morning. Some of you wouldn't even wait till Monday. And PETA would file a lawsuit. Like, that's what would happen. I can see the future. I know what would happen. And the reason I want you to get that visual is because you know that Charlie was made for water. You know this goldfish was made for water. And just as this fish was made for water, your soul was made for God. You were made to exist in the context of a relationship with God. You were made by God and you were made for God. And if he's outside of the water, he suffers. And when we live life separated from God, we suffer too. And in fact, some of us are more concerned about this fish being out of water than we are our souls being out of relationship with God. And Jesus gave his life so that we can be made right with God. So we experience his grace and his forgiveness. And in a moment, we can return to God. You understand that, right? Like, in a moment, you can be made right with God. In a moment. But it takes a lifetime of maturity to grow in that relationship. You can run to his arms, return to him, and in a moment be made right with him. Receive his grace and his forgiveness. But it takes a lifetime of growing in maturity. And what we're talking about is, how do we continue to grow in that relationship? There's a couple things I want you to know. The first one is modeled by Jesus, is that you grow where God has placed you. There is a temptation to think, you know what? When I get a new job, then I'll grow spiritually. And when I get that new season of life, then I'll grow. And when I move to a new city, then I'll grow spiritually. And when my spouse changes, then I'll grow spiritually. And my kids are older, then I'll grow spiritually. And when things change around me, then I'll grow spiritually. But what God is doing through spiritual growth, the thing he wants to change most is you. And if we're so focused on the context of our surroundings and saying, my growth is contingent on all these things changing, God's saying, you've missed it because I want to grow you right where I placed you. And God placed his son Jesus in Nazareth, which is a pretty strange place to put the Messiah. Because Nazareth is a little podunk town in backwoods Galilee, about 300 people. It's one of those towns where everybody knows everybody's business. Some of us went to schools about that size, where everybody knew everybody's business. And Jesus grew up in Nazareth. That was his hometown. I want you to tell the person next to you your hometown. Tell them the name of your hometown. Now, there's a tension when it comes to tell people your hometown. Because, see, I'm from Lawrenceville, Georgia. And most of the time when people say, where are you from? I say Atlanta. Why? Because nobody knows where Lawrenceville, Georgia is, right? And so all of us feel that tension in that moment. Most of us say the city that's the largest city, the known city that's closest. But Jesus was from Nazareth. And God used the obscurity of Nazareth to be the place where Jesus grew and developed. God matured him in that place of Nazareth. And here's what I love about God didn't waste a day of Jesus' development. And God didn't waste a day of your life and your development either. He was working all the time. And he strategically places us in places of obscurity so that he can grow and develop us. I mean, when you look back at Nazareth, you see how there's a strategy of it. I mean, Jesus was in an agricultural society. He was a carpenter. He grew up as a worker. He knew what it meant to work. And Jesus, he spent a lot of time around blue-collar people. He spent time around peasants. So that's the reason he connects so well with peasants. You see in his ministry that the kind of people that he spent most of his life with, he knew, and he was able to speak in ways that connected with them. Have you ever noticed the tenderness that he has toward widows in his ministry? How like he uses widows as illustrations? It's because it's most likely that his mom was a widow. Scholars tell us that it's most likely that Joseph died somewhere between when Jesus was 12 and when he was 30, which would have left his mother, Mary, a widow. And because Jesus was the oldest son, it would have meant that he had to bear the responsibility to provide for his family. So Jesus had to care for his mom, for his siblings. He had to become something of a father figure in the family. He knew the grind of providing. He knew how to work hard. He knew what taxation was like from the Romans. It was up to like 50%. Jesus knew that pressure. And it was in that realm that he matured spiritually, that he grew. He didn't go to seminary. He didn't go to Bible college. He didn't go to a spiritual retreat. It was in Nazareth where God grew him spiritually through the Father. And it's in the obscurity and it's in the place where he's planted you that he wants to grow you. And it grows every day in that relationship. And God doesn't waste your past. He actually uses your past to minister to people in your present and in your future. He doesn't waste a day. I remember one Sunday I was worshiping and I was thinking, I was like, man, God, you've asked me to lead at CrossPoint. Why'd you pick me? Like, I had no lead pastor experience. Like, there are a lot of other lead pastors you could have chosen. But I was a campus pastor at a church of many locations. Like, why'd you choose me? And I felt like God said in that moment, like, I want you to lead CrossPoint as a campus pastor, as one church with many locations. Here's what I mean. That when God looks at the church, Nashville, Middle Tennessee, he doesn't see thousands of churches. He sees one church with many locations. And that at CrossPoint, we're just one church, a part of a much bigger movement. Our many locations, we're part of many, 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 many locations. So when we partner with 300 churches to look for God's lost kids, that's the heart of the Father. That's why we do Awaken. But it's in obscurity that God grows and God develops. He doesn't waste a day of that. And so I want to talk about how God uses off the grid to form three things. And if you're writing it down, this is how he grows you in the relationship. The first is that off the grid is where we find our worth. Here's what I want you to see. When Jesus was baptized, and Luke tells us that Luke, later on in this chapter, it says that Jesus came out of ministry and or out of obscurity and entered into ministry with his baptism. Listen to what Luke writes. He says, when all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven opened and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven saying, you are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased. Now Jesus himself was about 30 years old when he began his ministry. Now what I want you to see is that the Father said to Jesus, you're my son, I love you, and I'm proud of you. But what had Jesus done? No great crowds, no great miracles, no great ministry. He'd been a carpenter for 30 years. Your worth to God does not depend on what you can do for God. You need to know that God says to you, you're my beloved daughter with whom I'm well pleased. And you're my beloved son with whom I'm well pleased. Not based on what you've done for God, but based on who you are to him. My boy started a lawn care business name of their lawn care business. We didn't file, so don't like report us. But their lawn care business is called Queen Green and Clean. It's tricky, but last name's Queen Green and Clean. Yep. So he started cutting our grass, and then the neighbors asked, "Hey, would you cut our grass?" And then they became a business, a kind of a thing. And so the neighbors paid really well, $20 a pop. We paid a lesser rate, and so they would go out and they would cut the grass. And so they had this thing going. Now it was a little bit different because with our neighbors, it was transactional. Their relationship with the neighbor was based on how well they did the lawn. Listen, their relationship with me as their father had very little to do with how they cut the grass. And I'm afraid that many of us treat God like the neighbor. Like, how well I do, God, that's it. And we think God's evaluating his love for us based on what we do. And rather, he's the father who says, I provide for you. I protect you. I am with you. I'll give everything. I have given everything in Christ for you. My love for you is not dependent what you do. Your value is not based on your performance. Off the grid seasons teach us that our worth comes from God, not from what we can accomplish, not from our work. Second thing off the grid shows us, off the grid reveals to us our character. It's where we find our character. See, when we're off the grid, we figure out who we really are. There's a great quote by John Wooden, UCLA basketball coach, famous basketball coach, legendary. He said, be more concerned with your character than you are your reputation, because your character is what you really are, while your reputation is merely what others think you are. Just let that soak in. We all have a backstage and a front stage, and integrity is when those two are the same. A while back, I got a text that said, your mic is on. The problem was it was in between services. So then I start going back through, what conversations did I have? What did I say, right? Did I go to the bathroom? I mean, I'm thinking about all this. And I started to think about that, and I was like, you know what? What if your mic was on the past 24 hours? What if other people could hear everything you said over the past 24 hours? If we go right there. And then we realize with a relationship with God, he's always aware. And not like a cosmic police officer going, I'm going to catch you doing wrong. But in that he loves us and he wants to form Christ in us. And here's what the enemy tries to get us to do. In the behind the scenes, tries to get us to go outside of the bowl, thinking that freedom is out here. That like freedom is in a private world. Freedom is in cheating. Freedom is in lying. Freedom is in addiction. Freedom is in porn. So freedom is all these things over here. But then we pursue those things and we find that we're gasping for breath and we're dying spiritually. When true life is found in the context of a relationship with God. And so it's our motivation for obedience, for walking with God is, God, I want to know you more and I want to walk in the freedom that you have. That's what God invites us to. And off the grid is where we find our character. And then last, off the grid is where we find our primary audience. It's where we find our primary audience. Matthew 5 through 7, Jesus gives his first sermon. Think about it. He's been working 30 years on this talk. No wonder it takes up three chapters. I mean, it's been percolating for 30 years, and the moment that he gets up to speak and he begins to talk about this off the grid and how to weave it into your life. And he says, when you pray, don't go stand up on the street corner and proclaim and broadcast your prayers. He says, find a closet and talk with God. He said, when you give, don't announce it and wave it around and say, here's what I'm giving. But he says, be secret so much that your left hand doesn't know what your right hand's doing. He said, when you fast, don't go around going, oh, I'm so hungry. I'm fasting because I love Jesus. I want to eat. He said, don't put it on blast. Keep it secret. Because if you put it on blast, if you do these things of faith for the approval of man, you better enjoy your reward because you just got it. But if you do these things in secret, your Father who sees what is done in secret, he will reward you. In other words, build off the grid into our faith that we wouldn't live for the approval of man, but we'd do it out of a relationship with the Father. So when we talk about fasting and this invitation into fasting, for you, it may be a really new conversation. For others, maybe you've heard about it, never done it. For others, maybe it's a part of your life. But what we mean is setting aside a period of time, a season of time, and giving up food, abstaining from food, to spend time in prayer, to focus on God. And when we talk about fasting, I mean, Jesus said, he said, when you fast, not if you fast. Meaning that it would be a part of our lives. And so we go, well, what did he mean by that? And how do we do that? He said, set aside that time. And for you, it may be in these 30 days, it may be every day one meal. It may be that you take 3 days out of the 30 days and fast and pray. It may be that you take an entire week out of 30 days. For some, it may be to fast the entire 30 days. For some, it may be, you know what, I'm going to fast. I'm not going to fast food. I'm going to fast food. No, it may be that I'm not going to fast food. I'm going to give up social media, or maybe give up Netflix, or maybe give up some form of entertainment. For others, it may be, you know, I'm going to fast food. And listen, fasting food is my least favorite discipline, but it's the most effective. I mean, I love food. But it's in that fasting, in that abstaining, that God grows me. And if you want to know more about fasting, in fact, there's a book that my friend Dave wrote. We'll have it out in the lobby. You can pick it up on the way out. It's a thin little book, but it's helpful. We go, what does it look like to fast? You go, well, why would we fast food? Let me give you two reasons. The first is, imagine that lady called me, and I called a lady, and we're talking through, and she's telling me she's driving north on 75, and I was like, listen, there's a great barbecue spot, and it's over, it's in Chattanooga, it's called Sugar Ribs, and it's incredible. You got to stop and get the ribs. Can you imagine what she would think? She'd hang up. You're crazy. Because I'm not thinking about food, I'm thinking about my lost son. And when we fast in a season, what we're saying is, I'm going to give up something I want for something I want more. I'm going to focus on what God's concerned about. And so it's not an obligation, you don't have to do it, but it's an invitation. I'd want to give you the opportunity to be a part. The other thing that I'll tell you is what God's done in my life personally is, in fasting, he's broken off some of the things that have become entangled in my life. Some of the habits, some of the patterns, some of the sins in the private world, he's used fasting, because when he gives you the grace to tell yourself no for food, you also find that you have the grace to tell yourself no for other things as well. And so it may be that through fasting, you find freedom from some of the other things that you've carried for a long time. And so I'd invite you to that. But you can be made right with God in a moment. It takes a lifetime to grow into who he's created you to be in that relationship. And so what I want to do is give an opportunity for some. Maybe today you're saying, I'm going to jump back in the bowl. I've been drifting and I've been moving far from God. And today I'm returning to that relationship. You can do that in a moment. But then once you're in that relationship, you were made for God, you grow in it. So we're going to pray, and then we're going to have a song together, a song of worship to sing together and to run back to him. And maybe for you today, this would be your prayer. I want to run back to you, God. Let me lead you with it. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. And we thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you that in a moment we can be made right with you because of the cross, because of what Jesus has already done. And so would today be our running? Would today be our returning? Would today our souls find the satisfaction that comes only from you? And then would you give us a hunger for you that's greater than anything this world has to offer? Would we pursue you? Would we pursue your heart? Would we continually return to your arms? Would we find the grace, the peace, and the forgiveness, the power and the presence, the life that we were created to live with you? And by continually returning to you, would we continue to grow spiritually? Would we grow in favor with you so that a world could see that life comes from you? Would we be fully alive in you? It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.